MedCram.com.
Welcome to another MedCram lecture. We're going to talk about pulmonary embolism. And as you can see here on our CT scan, here is the embolus right in the middle of the pulmonary artery. And the question is why is it there? How did it get there? And what do we do about it? Now, this video series contains a lot of information and charts that I want to move through efficiently. So we're going to do something a little different. I'm going to mix in some background slides that I'll illustrate on. So what we're going to talk about is the epidemiology, the diagnosis, treatment, and treatment involves a number of different aspects, including assessing the stability of your patient, what kind of medication do you want to start, how long do you want to start it for, if they're going to be IVC filters or not, some newer techniques, and then we'll talk about complications. So in terms of epidemiology, a couple of things to keep in mind, that we see this in about 100 out of 100,000 cases and slightly higher in males. And as you get older, the risk is going to go up, especially after the age of 75. There's about 100,000 deaths per year in the United States, although the death rate is decreasing because we're getting better at detecting it and treating it appropriately. And now the risk ratio has gone from 138 down to about 36 in the last 30 years. The 30-day mortality is 4 and 13% for 1 year. It's a common disease. You should know Virchow's triad, and they are number one, venous stasis, number two, endothelial injury, and number three, hypercoagulable state. So one of the things that you've got to realize about the diagnosis is that it's easy to miss. In fact, there was a Spanish study that showed it was misdiagnosed in one of three ED patients, and a retrospective review of pulmonary embolism in over 400 patients, they found that 146 had a delayed diagnosis. Some of the things that increased the risk of the diagnosis, of course, was hemoptysis. So anytime you see someone coughing up blood, you got to think of pulmonary embolism. COPD, you know, that's one of the things that we would look for. Hey, the guy's got COPD. Maybe he doesn't have a pulmonary embolism. Maybe his shortness of breath is from something else. Actually, that still increases the risk. So don't be fooled by if the patient has COPD. Pleuritic chest pain, of course, is pretty classic for pulmonary embolism. It increases the risk by 3.6. Asthma, believe it or not, cough, all of these things could increase the risk of a delayed diagnosis. Why? Because we're thinking about all of these other possibilities. Now, even though there was a delay in diagnosis in this, there was no statistically significant increase in mortality with that delay in diagnosis. So in terms of diagnosis, this is kind of the money slide when it comes to figuring out what the patient has and what to do about it. One of the things that you've got to look at is how likely does the patient actually have it? And you want to use the Wells criteria for that, or the modified Wells criteria. Basically what it is you're going through and you're assigning points based on what you see. So if the patient has clinical signs of DVT, like leg swelling, pain with palpation, the patient gets assigned 3 points. So what this means when it says that the PE is more likely than another diagnosis is, really, let's flip it around and say, is there something else that's more likely other than a PE? For instance, if you've got elevated neck veins and swelling in the lower extremities, and you've got curly B lines on the chest x-ray, well, maybe we're dealing with congestive heart failure, probably more likely than that of a pulmonary embolism. If the patient's got fevers, night sweats, chills, and they've got an elevated white count, and they're coughing up yellow sputum, and they came in last week for a pneumonia, then, you know, pneumonia is probably more likely than a pulmonary embolism, right? So if the patient's got a pneumothorax, then pneumothorax is probably more likely to explain the clinical symptoms of the patient, more likely than a pulmonary embolism. So in other words, if you see a diagnosis that stands alone by itself, and it's probably contributing to the signs and symptoms that we see, then go with that diagnosis and don't give the 3 points for a pulmonary embolism. But on the other hand, if you're seeing all of these signs and symptoms like tachycardia, tachypnea, shortness of breath, and you don't see a pneumonia, you don't see a pneumothorax, you don't see congestive heart failure, that's when you apply the 3 points. The PE is more likely than some other diagnosis. If they have a prior history of any kind of clot, 1.5, a heart rate greater than 100 gives them 1.5. If they've been immobilized for 3 or more days, that's another 1.5. If they've got hemoptysis or got malignancy, that gives you another point. So you add them up, and if it's 4 or less, the diagnosis is considered unlikely. If it's 5 or more, it's considered likely. And so what you do with those points is you determine what kind of tests you're going to get. And we'll talk about that. But here on the right side are the gamut of tests that are usually ordered. Now, notice something about these tests. The first thing that you'll notice is that these are tests that are ordered specifically if you're thinking about a pulmonary embolism. Notice that none of these tests are really done routinely, so you're not going to ever be surprised in the morning when the test comes back positive for PE. Whenever you get a positive test for PE, it's because you've thought about it. And herein lies the real crux of the problem with PE, is that if you never think about it, you'll never really make the diagnosis. So let's talk about these. CT angiogram. This is where a patient goes into the CT scan. They have to hold their breath for about 10 seconds or so, and the scanner quickly gets these images that looks specifically at the pulmonary artery. So these are great tests if it is a large PE, and if it's central. What I mean by that, it's big, it's in the large central pulmonary arteries. Not going to be so good if it's chronic and if it is in the peripheral vasculature, because the radiologist has to actually see the PE. Therefore, it's pretty specific. So it's central, and you got to be careful, however, of the GFR, because you got to give contrast to these patients. So the kidney has to be able to take that contrast. Okay, so if you've got bad kidney function, you can't use this test. The next one that's used, it's a little bit older, is a VQ scan. Also relatively specific. It looks better at peripheral. So this is the test that you want to use if you've got a patient with chronic thromboembolic disease, if they've had clots in the past, or if you think that they've been having increasing clots and their pulmonary artery pressure is going up. Don't get the CT angio, because that's going to tell you about acute clots centrally. What you want to do is actually look at the VQ scan. Because it uses a nuclear med and not contrast, the GFR is not an issue, so you don't have to worry about kidney function. However, if there is a pneumonia, then it may obscure the ability to tell whether or not there is ventilation but no perfusion. So usually if you've got a patient with a pneumonia and a good GFR, the one that you're going to use is a CT scan. If you've got a patient with a bad GFR, bad kidney function, but a clear chest x-ray, then a VQ scan is probably the one that you're going to use. Okay, next ones that you can use, ultrasound of the bilateral lower extremities, very specific. What I mean by that is if you have a negative test, you cannot rule out DVT or PE. If you have a positive study, though, you could probably rule in both. Definitely rule in a DVT and also rule in a pulmonary embolism. Here's the thing you ought to know about this test. It is portable, so you can actually bring it to the patient. If the patient's unstable in the emergency room, in the ICU, you're not going to induce any risk of taking the patient downstairs, because this can come to you. Also in that line is the D-dimer. However, it's not specific. So whereas an ultrasound, if it is positive, it helps you tremendously, and if it is negative, it doesn't help you much at all. Here, the opposite is the case. If the D-dimer is negative, it's very helpful in telling you that there's probably no clots going on at all, but if it's positive, there's 101 different things that could make this positive other than a blood clot. For instance, inflammation, surgery, things of that nature. Echoes are nonspecific. There is the occasional sign that you'll see where the apex may or may not be moving. There's also EKG. That's going to be nonspecific. You can think of an S1, Q3, T3. Chest x-ray is also nonspecific. You can think of Hamptons Hump or Westermark sign. Again, these are not specific or sensitive, but interesting and helpful to know. Okay, so how do you actually treat a patient whom you suspect of having a pulmonary embolism? So you're here at this point, either inpatient or outpatient. And so the first thing that you're gonna do is apply Wells criteria, and you add it up. And if it's 0 to 4 points, then it's gonna be unlikely. If it's 5 to 12.5 points, it's gonna be likely. So the next thing you do for an unlikely is check a D-dimer. If the D-dimer is negative, you're good. The pulmonary embolism is ruled out. And by negative, I mean less than 500 nanograms per milliliter. Now, if it's positive, then you treat it exactly as you would if you had a likely result from the Wells criteria that we talked about before. And in which case, what you do is you do a CTPA, provided, of course, that the kidney function is good enough. Now, if you do a CTPA, it's possible that you could miss some of those peripheral pulmonary embolisms. But the question is, are those peripheral pulmonary embolisms significant to the point where it would be fatal if you didn't anticoagulate. And that was the question that was set out for the Christopher study. So what they did was they used this algorithm, then they went and did a CTPA. And if it was positive in this case, then you've ruled in the pulmonary embolism. But if it was negative, they would send it and say, no, you've ruled out the pulmonary embolism. So what they said was, is this as good as the D-dimer and as other points? So what they did was they looked at the false positive rate. And they wanted to see if we anticoagulated all these people that were positive and didn't anticoagulate all the ones that were negative on the CTPA, how did it turn out in terms of DVT, non-fatal PE, or fatal PE? And we have those numbers right here in respective order. And you can see here that these false positive rates are pretty darn low. And this is basically what we do now in the emergency room, is we look at a patient, do the Wells criteria. If you've got an unlikely with a negative D-dimer, you're done. If you have either an unlikely with a D-dimer that's positive or a likely, you go to CTPA. If the CTPA is positive, well, you've made the diagnosis. If the CTA is negative, well, in that case, you're done. And here's an example of what a CTPA looks like. And you can see here that you've got clot blocking up this entire limb of the right pulmonary artery. This is the pulmonary artery right here. This is the aorta here. And here you can see it bifurcate. So this goes to the right and this goes to the left. And of course, you're seeing a clot in the lumen that's preventing the contrast from illuminating. You can see why a CTPA is better at detecting large central lesions rather than peripheral lesions. So here's an example of a pulmonary embolism. Here's an example of a ventilation perfusion scan. So there's a gas that you inhale and it determines where in these lungs do you see any decrease in ventilation. And of course, we do a technetium perfusion scan, and you can see clearly here areas that are not being perfused. And these, of course, don't match up with areas over here. And so what you have is a mismatch in perfusion ventilation, and therefore that's a high probability for a pulmonary embolism. Here's an example of a very specific finding. You'd be very surprised if you were to see this, is a Hamptons hump. And you can see here this wedge-shaped infarct in the periphery of the lung. And that is classic and very specific for a pulmonary embolism. Okay, well, that completes this portion of the epidemiology and diagnosis. Join us for the next video when we talk about treatment.